awful. You know, I don't know what to do. I get so bored, and Charles never pays me any attention. The press just hound me the whole time, just like did poor old Sarah. Look, if I can give the bodyguard the slip, can I meet you somewhere tonight? Usual place?
Okay, Squidgy. Safeway, 6 o'clock. Milky Milky.
Can I just say what a pleasure it is for both Steve and for me to be here with you all in Bristol? Yeah.
Please don't say that, because I mean it's just so obvious that that is just showbiz bullshit. I mean, you know, it's just so obvious that we just say that wherever we are. I mean, it's.
Yeah, but this time we're actually in Bristol. That's sort of why I said it,
Thing. Theoretically, it should have worked here.
Didn't particularly.
No, never mind. Still, no, yes. So what can we do to make your sacrifice worthwhile tonight? Well, first of all, I'm afraid something a little bit horrible is going to have to happen, because I'm afraid that Hugh here has insisted that he would like to do a quick impression for you, and... this is it, I'm afraid. This is the impression. This is probably about the best impression that Hugh does. And I think as the show goes on, that will become painfully obvious. And it is in fact an impression of God. He is moving in a mysterious way. Sorry about that joke, and I would like to say it is actually genuinely very nice to be here. It's very nice generally to be out on tour, out on the road.
This tour for us, you know, it's just like being in a road movie or something, isn't it? It's like Thelma and Louise. It's just us, the open road in our Austin Allegro.
Yeah, my Austin Allegro, in fact.
Yeah, your Austin Allegro with a crap radio and a coat hanger for an aerial.
Yeah, well, loads of people do that.
Not wooden coat hangers. You don't pick anything up.
That's fair enough. No, but we've got everything, though, for modern driving comfort. We've got those little metal tins of travel sweets. We've got a selection of new tapes from Picker Tape.
And we've got one of those beaded car seat covers.
That's right.
One of those beaded car seat covers, meant to help you relax. I don't get that. How can it be relaxing driving with an abacus up your arse? Oh, I'm feeling really stressed out now. I think I may do some anal arithmetic. One.
Plus every two.
Oh, it's stuck!
Two.
Move it.
Well, that's marvellous. 2 minutes into the show, the tone already substantially lowered.
One.
That's excellent. Let's start as we need to go on. Obviously, we are one, doing quite a bit. We are doing.
Three!
We are doing quite a bit of driving at the moment. Been driving around quite a lot, and I have to say, I've already noticed one or two things as we have been driving around. One very sad thing, for example, I have noticed that you do see a lot less hitchhikers around on the British roads than you used to, and this is a terrible shame. I think it's largely, because programmes like Crime Watch have frightened motorists off, you know, from giving people lifts anymore. It's a terrible shame, because you know, you see these people by the side of the road and they've got their little placard and they think the placard says this, but what they haven't worked out yet is that to the eyes of the motorist, the placard says this. You know, it's a terrible shame, I think, you know, it's just, it's, it's just a very sad, you know, comment on modern society. Mind you, of course, though, sometimes you do have to see it from the point of view of the motorist, you know, because you know how every now and then, you know, you're driving along and you spot someone by the side of the road and you think, now, there's no way that bloke is going to get a lift. You know. frankly, it isn't, you know, very likely to happen. Although, though, we do actually have a little bit of a soft spot. We do have a little bit of a sort of a soft spot for driving matters generally, because the first job that we ever actually did together was we actually used to write those funny stickers that go on the backs of cars.
Oh, they're funny, aren't they?
You,
my goodness,
you know, the
funny,
sort of thing. And it was a great job to have as well. It's a marvellous job to have, because they started us off nice and easy, you know, 9 o'clock Monday morning, sat us down and said, OK, we'll start you off with windsurfers. Have a go at windsurfers and what they do. So we had a bit of a think about that. We came up with windsurfers go windsurfing. And they said, no, you're missing something here, you see, because there has to be a little bit of a sort of a risque element to it, you know. There must be more sort of windsurfers and what they do in bed, you know.
In bed,
you
see,
sort of
in bed.
Touch of innuendo about it. So we had a think about that, innuendo. And we came up with windsurfers go to sleep standing up. Standing up, you see, that was the twist, although they still didn't go for it. Although, fortunately, Hugh did come to our rescue, came up with a marvellous bumper sticker.
Don't follow me, or you'll end up at my house.
Now, they seem to go for that one, they preferred that one. Now, I have to say that cars, though, as far as I'm concerned, cars are not a particularly big deal, although... I know that for a lot of people, a car is a big, big status symbol. And I remember it's like there was always some bloke at school who was always on and on about his dad's car.
Yeah, my dad's got a better car than you.
Oh, yeah, what kind of car's your dad got in
it? My dad's got a Ferrari. Yeah.
Well, I don't believe you,
well,
mate.
Well, that's right, it's a really good one, because it's a Ferrari estate.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sussed. Anyway, so, as I say, We are obviously doing quite a lot of driving at the moment, and of course when you are doing a lot of driving, it can be very worrying.
It can be very, very tiring. But fortunately, we have the security of knowing that we are members of Britain's largest motoring organisation.
That's right, yeah. And that of course does take out a lot of the stress and the worry.
Yeah, every night we leave the theatre to drive to the next gig. We drive for about 2 miles, deliberately sabotage the car and spend the rest of the journey in the AA relay van.
That's right. And this is a great plan, because we've actually worked out, we reckon we're going to be able to do a 45-show national tour on a fiver's worth of petrol.
Less if we're lucky.
Less,
could be
probably,
less.
Yeah,
could be less.
If we're lucky. And we don't really even have to pretend to break down, to be honest.
No, the AA, they send someone to the theatre now to pick us up. Yeah, he's round the back. He's round the back having a beer and a sandwich. Yeah. He's a very nice man.
He's a very nice man. very, very nice.
Actually, he's not. He's a bit of a wanker, to be honest. Yeah.
To be fair, no, that is, sort of, you know, to be fair, I think that is the word.
A wanker.
Now, when we are driving, of course, when we are driving, Hugh actually does tend to do most of the driving. It's just something he seems to enjoy, you know. And
that's the wrong foot.
It's, and I have to say that when we are driving, it does have one rather irritating habit. Although, to be fair, it is a habit that a lot of people do have. It's like, you know, when you're on the motorway and you're hammering along, you're making really good progress, you really don't want to have to stop, but you are running a little bit low on petrol and you spot one of those signs that says...
Services 1 mile or 32 miles.
And then the driver says...
Oh, I think we can make it to the second one.
Now, why? You see, why do they do this? Is it because they like worrying, or is it because they know that when they get there, the only thing left to eat is going to be a three-month-old Ginster's pasty? I've never worked this out. But I'll tell you one thing, though, when you do get to the garage, you may be lucky, there may be some petrol there, you never know, but I'll tell you what, there will definitely be, at the garage, there will definitely be some bags of fertiliser and some charcoal briquettes. Because all garages sell these, and no one has ever worked out why. Now, it's as if they expect every customer to be an arable farmer on his way to a barbecue. And of course, the other thing is garage mechanics, right? Garage mechanics are the same wherever you go, right? Even in the pits at a Grand Prix. I think this is, you know, I can quite understand why it is that Nigel Mansell has chosen to get out of Formula One, go to America, when you think of some of the things his mechanics have managed to do to him over the last couple of years. There was one particular incident last year that made me think that those blokes, right, those blokes who work in the pits at a Grand Prix. Now, what is their job? They have to remember to change his tyres once in 73 laps. And it's not even difficult. They're in radio contact.
Oh, hello, Nigel.
Hello, Nigel. You're all right, Nigel. Yeah, he says he can come and do his tyre change on the next lap or on lap 72.
Oh, I think he can make it to lap 72.
Yeah, I think he can make it, Nigel. No, no, he says he wants to come in now.
Is he coming in now? You've forgotten your charcoal briquettes.
You've forgotten them. They're down here, mate, and we've got a lovely barbecue going and everything.
I think this could just do with another couple of minutes.
Oh, it's a terrible business. A terrible business.
Nothing quite as funny as a wobbly sausage.
Although I have to say...
That's a right hand?
I have to say, though, that I think that the... I think that the real reason... Well, that looks nasty. Marvellous. I think, though, that the real reason why Nigel Mansell has chosen to leave Williams Renault is probably much more simple. Basically, I reckon he just cannot stand any longer having to work for Renault, because it's been so bloody irritating for him. You know, every time he's won a Grand Prix, drives back to the pits, and there they all are going, Papa!
Nico! Nico!
Yeah, this is enough to drive anybody mad, isn't it? And incidentally, I've spent about the last 6 months trying to work out what on earth is going on in that advert, hey? What is going on in that advert? As far as I can work it out, Nicole waits until she thinks Papa is asleep and then whips off for a shag, right? The moment she's gone, Papa whips off for a shag. Now, what has that got to do with Renault, hey?
It'd surely be much easier if they each waited until they were both awake. And then they shagged each other. It's just an idea.
Yeah, of course, driving is extremely dangerous, even at the best of times. And that is why, of course, that is why the government make all those marvellous safety information films to help you be a safer driver. I do love those. That was a government information film. You do only tend to see them at 3 a.m. after the late film is finished, but they are marvellous, covering such fascinating subjects as the dangers of smoking in bed, the dangers of swimming when the red flag is flying, and, of course, the dangers of overtaking on motorways.
Now, what's fascinating about all these films is the fact that they were all made in the 1970s and have never been updated. So all the men have Engelbert Humperdinck sideburns and wear tank tops. All policemen ride bicycles. And everybody drives the Austin 1100, which is why overtaking on motorways was so dangerous.
Now, the best will often tend to be the simplest, and the best ever government road safety campaign was the one called the Curb Drill, because it was incredibly easy to remember. It just went,
look right, look left, look right again, and if there's nothing coming, you obviously don't live in London.
But at some point, right, for some reason, they decided to change this, and they changed it to something called the Green Cross Code. Now... I could never understand the Green Cross Code, because it seemed to me like that the Green Cross Code was completely confusing for the very children that it was supposed to be helping, right? Because it totally contradicted every other road safety film you had ever seen, because one minute you were watching one road safety film that was telling you,
don't talk to strangers!
And the next minute you were watching another road safety film in which two kids were happily chatting away to a tall, muscular man in green tights. With an old green curtain wrapped round him, who would appear next to them and offer to help them home from school. And, you know, I never really sort of... coming Delta Foxtrot Tango, descend to 20,000 feet, maintain current AS. So go on, what did he say then?
Well, he said if you try and see Caroline again, I'll call the police.
Oh, go on, please. Hello. Yes, hello, Charlie Victor Tango. Yes, Roger, follow 178279 to intercept ILS.
Which flight is that?
No idea, the radar's broken. hello, yes, Roger, you are clear to land. I'm afraid we haven't got any radar. Sorry about that. So if you descend to 2,000 feet and look out for a church on the left. See a church on the left, and then you can't miss it. You're looking for a long strip of runway with little coloured lights down it, all right? It's Monarch. Monarch Flight 29 to Ibiza requesting permission to take off.
He's got a hope, hasn't he? Charter flight to Spain and he wants to take off.
Hello, Monarch Flight 29. Don't be silly. Anyway, so what's after that?
Well, he said to Caroline... Oh, I don't believe this.
Oh,
hello, Monarch. Yes, we'd love to give you permission to depart, but I'm afraid there are quite a few delayed flights in front of you.
Yes.
How many waiting to take off?
Well, there's still quite a queue.
That BOAC comet's still there.
The Wright brothers are still there, I think. Hello, sorry, Monarch, you are going to have to wait just for... Oh, hold on, the radar's back on.
Oh, brilliant, that's useful, isn't it?
Yes.
So that's Air Canada. That's British Airways coming in from Athens.
Yeah.
And that's
a bit of sandwich.
That's
I think.
A bit of sandwich.
Right, oh, hang on. I think we've got bloody Air Canada on
this
the line.
This is Air Canada. Will you please give us permission to land?
Oh! Hello, Air Canada. Yeah, I'm sorry, but Gatwick is very busy this morning. If you'd like to join the stack at 13,000 feet. Yeah, any more language like that and I'll divert you to Prestwick. On second thoughts, there's an airport there.
Bloody nerve. I think we'll have to get rid of him,
don't you? Yeah, let's get rid of him.
Hello, Air Canada. You should be receiving us loud and... This is 97.3, the HUD FM.
And with one phone to go, looks like Glenn's rod has got to win his first death.
Calling all cars, please investigate disturbance at the Dog and Bucket. Yeah,
let's
got rid of him, I think.
I'm going to make that announcement.
Yes, I think you had, yeah.
This is an announcement for all passengers hoping to travel to Lanzarote on flight 433. We regret to announce
be at least 9 hours.
A slight delay to your flight. However, if you'd like to make your way to the entertainment lounge, we will be showing the feature film Disaster at 30,000 feet.
Roger, Vector Bravo. Now, you are clear and have permission to come in straight away.
Who's that, then?
That's the pizza we ordered.
Oh, good. Bloody Monarch still bleating on me.
The problem is, you know, that some of these pilots have worked out it's much quicker if they don't take off at all.
Yes.
I mean, only last week I had a Britannia Airways 737.
Oh, yeah.
He was delayed, he taxied down to the end of the runway, out of the airport, down the A23 to New Haven and got on a ferry.
Oh. Much quicker, probably.
Oh,
hang on, hold up. We've got a takeoff slot.
Oh, my goodness, mate, we've got a takeoff slot. Right, here we go. A message for all planes wishing to depart. We do have a takeoff slot in 10 minutes or so for one of you. I'll start the bidding at a bottle of whiskey.
A bottle of whiskey. Hello and welcome along to a brand new series of Wish You Were a Holiday, the programme where Judith Chalmers gets 2 weeks in Antigua and Greg gets a free fortnight in the Bahamas and some poor junior bastard gets to go donkey trekking round Wolverhampton. Later on, we'll be looking at this year's newest and biggest holiday destination, Euro Disney, where you can meet and shake hands with 6-foot-tall versions of your favourite cartoon characters. A weekend for a family of four will be around £500, or there is a cheaper alternative. Lock yourselves in Toys R Us and drop some acid. So now I think we can go before the first was this week's filmed reports from Ian.
Tar very much, Steve. Yeah, I spent a week here on the Costa del Sol in the Hotel Criminalis in Fuengirola, where ETA, the Basque separatist movement, have claimed responsibility for the food. The prices are reasonable. You can have 1 week's full board, 2 weeks half board, or 3 weeks well bloody board for around £200.
Now, don't forget, of course, that all these prices quoted are for two adults sharing a twin room with shower, and not, as we said earlier, for two adults sharing a shower in a twin room. Apart, that is, from the rather dubious weekend in Bangkok, where the price is for two twins sharing an adult in a shower room.
Talking of which, Club 1830 are doing a roaring trade. I spent a week on the Greek island of Snoginos and returned with happy memories. Till I noticed the rash.
Now, don't of course, forget that, as ever, there are a large number of activity holidays on offer. Why not spend a week in Italy? If you go there in a party of 10 or more, you may be asked to form a government. Ian.
Or if you're more interested in England, why not go on a Graham Taylor management weekend with a special excursion to a local brewery where you can watch him try and organise a piss-up. Well, that's about all for this week. Next week, we'll be canoeing with John Major. He's going up Shit Creek without a paddle.
Oh, Sassar. To be fair, almost any of it has to be better than risking a holiday in this country. I know it's a bit of a dodgy thing to say, but British holidays are not the greatest. It is true, for example, that it does rain virtually the whole time. And this is, of course, why we've started to build centre parks, which are the ideal British holiday destination. If you fancy a week in a greenhouse outside Worksop. I always went on holiday within Britain as a kid. And the thing that I really remember about it more than anything, because it rained the whole time, is... The thing that really sticks in my mind is everywhere you went, you had to remember to take your Pack-a-Mac. Right, it's a brilliant little thing. It's like this little sort of coloured plastic raincoat which folded up really small so it could go in your pocket. The idea being that when it rained, you could take it out, you could put it on, and you could walk round for the entire duration of the shower looking like a Durex Fiesta. And incidentally, right, while we're on the subject, I have never understood what is the point of coloured condoms. I mean, what is the point of coloured condoms? They are completely stupid. They can be extremely worrying.
Oh, my God, I've got jaundice.
No. Once that's happened to you, don't forget it in a hurry, I can tell you. And, of course, the other thing, if you do go on holiday in this country, you will avoid one rather irritating thing, which will almost invariably happen to you if you go on holiday abroad, which is that you come back, right? You come back. And the first thing that everybody says to you is...
You're not very brown.
Now, this really gets on my nerves, because this is what? This is the only point of going on holiday, is it? Or, I don't know, do they mean this as a compliment? But, you know, who takes "you're not very brown" as a compliment?
Michael Jackson.
Well, yeah, very probably, I suppose, yes. But I'm prepared to let that pass. The other thing about going on holiday... As a kid, is that you tend to have to go with your parents. You know, you're too young to go on your own. You have to go where your parents want to go, do what your parents want to do. And there does really come a time when you really don't want to have to go on holiday with your parents anymore. And in fact, there does really come a time when virtually everything that your parents do becomes an embarrassment to you. And I think you may know the sort of parents we're talking about here. We are talking about... This is the sort of parent who will walk into the room while you're watching Top of the Pops and say,
"Hey, what's this? It's got a good beat."
And then start dancing. And in that way, right? And in that way that, like, you know, only parents can dance like this. You know, I mean, I don't know if there are any parents here tonight, but you know, if there are, you know, word of advice: never dance in front of your children, right? Just do not do it. It will just mortify them. Basically, you know, the rule is parents just shouldn't dance. You know, it's like Lord Hailsham playing Nintendo. It just shouldn't happen.
This is your Dire Straits album, isn't it? I wish I hadn't sat on that abacus. I think I've just solved a quadratic equation.
It's an appalling business. It is an absolutely appalling business. And embarrassing dads will do any... They will do any manner of crap things, embarrassing dads. They will forget, for example, that at school you never like anyone to find out the real name that they lumbered you with, and then they'll wait till all your mates come round and then walk in and say,
"Don't be late back from your jig, Belvedere."
And then, of course... Then, of course, there's mums.
Now, mums have this overwhelming desire to guide you down the right path. Whatever you want to do, whatever you're thinking of doing, your mum will already have done it and will always say...
"Look, I don't want you to make the same mistake that I made."
Which left me wondering how my mum had managed to get her head kicked in for nicking Martin Nichols' bicycle pump. But never mind.
But the terrible thing, right, the really terrible thing is that... It doesn't matter how hard you try, right? It does not matter how hard you try, but gradually, as you get older, you will slowly but surely find that you do gradually start to turn into your own parents. So this is a terrible thing because, of course, this is the one thing in life that we want more than anything else to avoid. But it happens. I do not know why this happens. It just happens. And you know that this nightmare is starting to come true for you if ever you catch yourself saying anything like,
"Hey, that's my chair."
Come on. Hop, 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 hop. Or...
Oh, I think we can make it to the second one.
Or you walk in while Top of the Pops is on and say,
who's that?
Or even worse...
Hey, what's this? It's got a good beat.
It's a terrible business. It's an appalling business, it really is. And parents as well. Parents have all these, like, you know, big plans for you as well, you know. Parents have all this list of, like, really dull, respectable jobs they want you to do, you know. Something like, oh, they say, well, why don't you be an accountant or a barrister or a doctor, you know. Doctor, that's like the ultimate respectable profession as far as parents are concerned. I have no idea, really, why this should be the case. I can only assume it's because of the immense amount of trust that we have to place in doctors.
Yeah, you name me another profession where you let a complete stranger grab hold of your scrotum and say, cough.
Apart from policemen, obviously. although, to be fair, they will normally grab it and say, confess. And, of course, the other thing is to find that can happen with embarrassing parents is there will come a time when, of course, they will talk to you about sex. Now, this is obviously going to be embarrassing. And the very worst mistake that they can make here is they can try and give it the old, hey, don't forget, I was young once bit.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with sex, Belvedere. Before I met your mother, I was at it like a rabbit. But you do know that the responsible male always takes precautions. Like Zebedee from the Magic Roundabout. He had a coil fitted to him instead of Florence.
To be honest, I've never really quite understood why it is that... Why is that parents bother talking to children about sex? Because they must know, right? They must know that by the time you get into your early teens, you're not really thinking about much else anyway. And especially boys, obviously, boys when they get into their very early teens, I'm quite convinced that English teachers in schools like to actually actively encourage this, you know, in early teenage boys, because it does tend to produce feats of creative imagination that are going to be unmatched anywhere else later in life.
You see that girl over there? Yeah, I might get off with her because she fancies me, yeah, I might get off with her.
Well, I don't care, right, because I've already got a girlfriend.
Oh, yeah, what's her name?
Joanne.
Well, Joanne Graham?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I got off with her at a party.
Well,
yeah.
I don't care, right, because I've snogged her and I've snogged all the girls in the whole school.
What, and the sixth form?
Yeah, and two of the teachers.
Well, you snogged Miss Hargreaves?
Yeah.
What? French?
No, she teaches history. Ah! See, you're sus, right? Yeah, because I've got off with millions of girls, right? Because I got off with Pippa Forrester out of BFT.
Well, that's nothing, right? Because I got off with the blonde one off of Baywatch.
Well, I don't care, right? I don't care because I got off with what's name out of Darling Buds of May.
What, David Jason? Anyway, girls like me because I've got lots of stubble.
You don't have to shave.
I do have to shave. I have to shave three times a day. With a Black and Decker sander. Anyway, I've done it.
You've never done it.
I've done it.
You've never done it.
I've done it. I'm telling you, I've done it.
You've never done it. Well, you've never done it because you have to be 16.
Well, she thought I was 16.
Oh, yeah, well, right, yeah, because I went to like this really posh pub, right, where you have to be like 21 before they let you in, and they thought I looked it easy.
Yeah, well, that's nothing, right? Because I got into this shop, right? I got into this shop where you have to be 45 before they let you in.
What shop?
Littlewood. Sassy. Littlewood, yeah.
Littlewood, yes. There's another place that parents would drag you kicking and screaming at the beginning of a new term. This, of course, is not to say that parents couldn't come in useful, because, of course, they could. They're always useful, for example, for getting you a day off school. You know, woke up with a little bit of a headache, something like that, fancied a little bit of day off. They could always write a little note, little letter, get you off for the day. In fact, it's sort of interesting. You sort of chart the whole course of your early life through those little notes, little letters you were sending or receiving at any given time. Your whole kind of youth spreads out in front of you. Age, 8 weeks.
Dear Mrs. Dennis, here is your son's vaccination certificate. You successfully vaccinated 47 people. Congratulations.
Age, 8 years.
Dear Mr. Hopkinson, please will you let Hugh off PE today, as he's asked me to write you this letter.
Yours, Mrs. Dennis.
Age, 18 years.
Dear Hugh, this is a hard letter to write, but it's over between us. It'll never work with you going on to university and me staying at the sixth form college. Yours, Mr. Hopkinson.
horribly true. And this, of course, brings us on to the hideous things that can happen to you when you are at school. And here, I must confess, I am basically just sharing with you a little bit of a personal gripe of my own that has been with me ever since I left school. And it concerns the way that they make you try and learn other people's, other countries' languages, right? Now, you would think in this day and age that this would be a good thing, but I am not so sure, right? Because to illustrate this, I would like to read you a few bits of this. This is actually a real book that they gave me at school to try and learn German out of. It's my school German textbook. It's quite a common one. This is called Sprich mal Deutsch, which means speak German badly or something. And as I say, this is quite a common textbook in British schools. And the idea of this is supposed to be one of these very modern, trendy, up-to-date textbooks where what they're doing is they're actually teaching you stuff that will actually be useful. You know, when you go to the country and you want to talk to people, you go to that country, you want to hold conversations with people in their native tongue. And in fact, as it says in the introduction, the accent in this book is at all times placed on everyday practical German. Great. Right, so we turn to page one, and we find sentence one. Das ist eine Katze. That is a cat. Well, some supremely practical and everyday German there. I think you can probably see that given the situation of being in Germany, right, and confronted with such an animal, this is almost certainly what you would say. You don't have a lot of choice in the matter, to be honest. If you saw a cat and said, ah, there is a refrigerator, no one would know what the hell you were talking about. However, of course, maybe you have made some awful mistake. I don't know, maybe being abroad has thrown you. Maybe German cats look completely different. Maybe this one is deliberately trying to fool you. It's got a little pair of shades on, something like that. I don't know. Maybe your powers of observation have totally let you down. Maybe there's been some horrible mistake. And maybe the native German might have to put you right, probably by using sentence two. Ja, das ist eine Katze. Yes, that is a cat. So, already a conversation is underway. How does this fascinating conversation proceed? Well, probably via sentence three. Ist die Katze grün? Is the cat green? To which you probably leap straight to sentence four. Nein, die Katze ist schwarz. The cat is in fact black. Sentence five. Ist die Katze tot? Is the cat dead? Again, I don't know, probably an easy mistake to make. You know, a lot of British visitors not realising the propensity of the common or garden German cat to lie on the ground on its back with its legs in the air, just to confuse foreigners. However, of course, this sort of stuff, this is really only the basic sort of building blocks of learning a language. And when we've mastered it, we can get onto the advanced stuff like this. This is chapter 8. It's called In the Countryside. Today, the Ehlers family are going to the countryside. Toll, das Land, sagt Hans, es ist voller Insekten. Hooray! The countryside, says Hans. It's full of insects. Which is a marvellously useful sentence at almost all times, I think you'll find. And this is my favourite sentence in the whole book. Page 61, sentence 5. Hans ist nass. Hans is wet. Which you'll already know if you've read the rest of the book. Hans is supposed to be 16 and he still wears shorts. Leather shorts, mind you, but... shorts anyway. Anyway, Hans ist nass, Hans ist wet. Obvious question, warum ist Hans nass? Why is Hans wet? Answer, Hans ist nass, denn steht unter einem Wasserfall. Hans is wet because he is standing under a waterfall. And there he is, you see, this is a real book. So these are, and you struggle through this sort of rubbish for, I don't know how long, 3, 4, 5 years, and just as you think you're about to escape from it, just as you think you're about to get free, what happens? What happens? They make you take exams on it. Now, every summer, they start saying, oh, exams are much easier to pass than they used to be. Oh, educational standards are falling. Let me tell you, it is not true.
Exams never, ever change.
They do not change. They never have changed, they never will change. For example, they have still not worked out, right? They have still not worked out that everybody in history who has ever taken any sort of exam has always, wherever they can, opted to do the multiple choice section of the paper. Because they know, right, they know that multiple choice is what is technically known in educational terms as a piece of piss. Right? It's a piece of piss, because although it looks like there are four possible answers to choose from, there's always actually only three, because one of them is always really obviously wrong, right? So you might be doing like a biology test or something, and they give you a question like...
What is the name of the fluid that lubricates the joint at the elbow?
Is it A?
Synovial fluid?
B?
Synoptical fluid?
C?
Hemiopteric fluid?
Or D?
Jeff Hurst in the 1966 World Cup final.
See, there's always one like that, you see. There's always one, you see, like that. Hemianotrophilia, which is a complete giveaway. And then they say, oh, if you've got to do exams, right, plan your time. Plan your time in the exam room really carefully. It makes no difference, all right, because all exams go exactly the same way.
9 o'clock.
Arrive in the exam room. Realise you're in the wrong room.
9.05.
Arrive in the correct room. Complete silence.
9.06.
Realise the person next to you is going to be coughing for the next 3.5 hours.
9.10.
Start planning first essay.
9.10 and a half.
Start writing first essay.
9.35.
Someone farts and everyone starts giggling.
10 o'clock.
200 digital watches make horrid beeping noises.
10.15.
The hardest bloke in the class walks out early.
10.16.
The hardest bloke in the class is pushed back in again by his mother. You see?
Never changes. Never ever changes.
Does not change. Now, maths. There was another subject I could never come to terms with. Could never understand the point, really, the point of having to try and learn maths. It's only now, really, far too late. I've just about worked it out. I reckon, basically, you need virtually a degree in maths if you're ever going to make head nor tail of any of those interminable and incomprehensible financial programmes.
Hello and welcome to City News. The day's top stories. United Amalgamated bid for Consolidated Incorporated. Incorporated United in leveraged buyout struggle. And Amalgamated Consolidated offer a second rights issue ahead of half-year profit announcement. Later on we'll be asking, who gives a toss? We'll also be asking, what's the best way to get a guaranteed overdraft? The answer, of course, spend more money than you have in your bank account. Those stories now in detail. John Major and Helmut Kohl have had a major disagreement over ERM. John Major contends that Shiny Happy People was their best single. But Kohl likes Orange Crush. The pound dropped further today and failed to hold its value against the German mark, the Portuguese escudo, and the Esso World Cup coin collection. At the close, it had dropped 4 points against the dollar. The franc had dropped 2 points against the peseta, and Nottingham Forest had dropped 3 points against almost everybody. In spite of this, Norman Lamont claimed today that the end of the recession is definitely in sight. He also claimed he'd seen Elvis at the deli counter in Tesco's. On the stock market, shares were again shaky. They rose on opening after supply figures were released, but slipped back mid-morning after disappointing interim results, only to rise again after it was announced that there was lasagna on the menu in the canteen. News that a man had fallen off a bus in Gloucestershire sent dealers into panic selling, and when Jeremy at Hambros remembered that he'd forgotten to set the video for Inspector Morse, the market collapsed completely. This provoked criticism from the Germans that John Major has gone soft. A spokesman for the German government said today, John Major is becoming wet because he is standing under a waterfall.
Thank you. Enjoy your meal.
Right, Gary, next customer's all yours.
Good morning. Can I help you? 2 quarter pounders. Thank you. Enjoy your meal.
Gary, you didn't ask him if he wanted fries.
What, chips?
No. Fries, Gary, they're called fries.
Well, if he wanted chips, he would have asked for them.
No, that's not the point, though, is it, Gary? The point is that whatever the customer orders, you must remember to always say, do you want fries with that? Right.
Do you want chips?
No, Gary. It's fries, OK? It's fries. And always remember to smile.
Do you want chips? What if he just wants a milkshake?
Fries with a shake.
What if he just wants fries?
Fries with your fries. Look, thank you, Gary. I'm watching you. Crew member of the month, 5 stars, and don't you forget it. 2 G1 quote G. Be a couple of minutes.
Do what?
If the customer orders something that's not ready on the hot plate, Gary, you must get it specially ordered.
Well, how do I do that?
I just showed you. You say 2 G1 quote G. Be a couple of minutes.
2 chicken 1 quarter cheese. Be.
No. See, nothing's arrived on the hot plate, Gary, because I could hear the words, you see. It confuses me. I don't want to hear the words. It's 2 chicken 1 quarter cheese.
2 chicken 1 quarter cheese. Be a couple of minutes.
It's much better, Gary. Right, I'm going over here to rattle the chip fryer in a self-important way. Alan, could you mop the floor, please? Could you mop the floor? It hasn't been mopped now for nearly 3.5 minutes. So... Another customer, Gary.
Do you want fries with that?
No, Gary. Take the order first, Gary.
Good morning, can I help you?
Where's your happy hat?
Good morning, can I help you?
How does the customer know, Gary? Go to the next till. How does the customer know? How does the customer know he's walked into a fast food establishment, eh? Because I'll tell you why, Gary. Wherever he is in the world, he can walk through our door and the first thing he sees is a bloke in a paper Thunderbird hat pushing a mop for no discernible reason. Alan, we're getting rather busy. Rope off another section of seating, can you? Isn't
they? Hard to believe he's chicken griddler of the fortnight.
Let's chat more product, Darren.
Customer wants ordinary chips.
Regular fries, Gary. And what do we use for regular fries?
The Menke paper bag.
Right. What do we use for large fries?
The designer executive French fry pouch.
Right, Gary. Two dark cokes.
You want what? An orange juice?
Over there. 2-2-1-2.
Oh, I wouldn't recommend the orange juice. I mean, the man from Del Monte, he say...
To be rude to a customer, Gary, you know the golden rule. The customer is always right.
He asked for chips.
It's fries, you pillock. 2-2-1-2.
Crew leader, what's a thick shake?
It's an Arab leader with a low IQ, Gary. What are you thinking? Okay, you pull the lever there, you stick the cup under there. If it's coming out runny, stick a bit more of that in it, okay?
He says, do we sell fish and chips?
We don't sell chips or fish. It's fries and fillet.
What, the fillet?
No, it's not fillet, Gary. It's fillet.
Okay. Oh, 2 chicken, 1 quart cheese, 1 fillet.
See, for the 90s, Gary, he's not interested in fish and chips.
Do we do pizza?
Pizza? Huh. Only the Italians could get away with charging £4 for posh cheese on toast.
Italian food, me, spaghetti, ravioli.
Ravioli? It's like eating 2 postage stamps full of sick.
Would you kebabs?
No, look, why don't you just have a burger?
No, not even I can eat a doner kebab. It's like eating an old wallet stuffed with used odour eaters.
What?
Is that about right?
Beautiful, beautiful, Gary. Lovely, lovely.
Thank you. Enjoy your meal.
Of course, the other thing about all those places that do, like, you know, pizza and pasta is that they do also tend to involve the unmitigated horror that is the salad bar.
Yes, sir, we do have a salad bar, a selection of various manky vegetables, all in plastic trays. You'll notice the skillful way in which we spilt sweet corn into all of them. Yes, there's a choice of dressings. There's French, Italian and blue cheese. That's the oily one, the one that looks like snot, and the one that looks like... Well, to be honest, it looks like...
Yeah, all right, I think we know.
With sweet corn in it. I hate sweet corn. I hate sweet corn. It's completely indigestible. You eat a tin of sweet corn, it comes out as corn on the cob.
Now, a lot of those places, of course, that... A lot of those places that involve proper waiters can often tend to be a bit daunting because sometimes it does feel like a lot of waiters just seem to have been specially trained in the fine art of trying to make you feel completely inferior. Excuse me, what could you recommend, please?
I recommend you try and look less poor, sir. Have you ever been to a harvester before?
And, of course, food is also one of those things that will tend to change according to where you are in the world. For example, it's quite common in France to find that restaurants do serve horse meat. And, to be honest, this does tend to cause a lot of problems for British tourists. So, excuse me, garçon, what could you recommend, please?
I recommend a pepper steak trained by Gaston Leroux, owned by Anne-Marie Leclerc. The going is good to medium rare. Chop chop worth the risk of current prices in their way. And onto the grill. And it's chop chop on the left with sausages on the right. And as they come up to the first turn, in goes the spatula. And chop chop has fallen. Chop chop has fallen. That leaves sausages. Sausages which have been in the fridge for 6 weeks.
Oh.
And they're off.
Oh. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I really couldn't. I could not do it. I would find it very, very difficult to eat horse meat because I do actually really like horses, and especially shire horses, because they're like ordinary horses, but in flared trousers. Yes, that's what I like about them. Now, I just wanted to say something briefly here because we are sort of just coming up towards the interval now. And just before we go to the interval, I would just like to say something very deeply heartfelt, and that is that it is so very marvellous to see so many people out supporting live entertainment, because I do sometimes get a little bit worried about the future of live entertainment in this country, and I don't want to get worked up about this, or I don't want to get emotional about this, but, well, it's the Chippendales, if you must know. The Chippendales are Baywatch without the plot, aren't they? The Chippendales are for people who find Gladiators too intellectually demanding. You know, the Chippendales are people who watch the telly and think, oh, I must buy myself one of those abdominizers. The Chippendales are people who go to careers interview and say, what I really fancy doing is standing there every night in a thong covered in Mazzola. Now, it's not that we're bitter, all right? It is not that we are bitter, and it is not that we are in any way made to feel inadequate by these people. It is quite simply that,
I know what you're thinking. It's quite impressive, isn't it?
Would you look at that?
I think, sir, a phrase does spring to mind, yes.
Sex on a stick, probably, is it, Albert?
No, I was thinking more of what the fuck are you doing, really? I mean, where's your swimming from?
I honestly don't care, Steve. A lot of these people are going to be moist in some pretty private places. Nothing quite as funny as a wobbly sausage, is there? That's what I mean.
Sad as you like. I mean, can't believe it. I mean, just, I'm so sorry. I just, you know...
This is what people want, Steve.
No, this is not what these people want, believe me.
No.
This is a...
I've got a bit of fluff down there, look.
I do not know what I'm supposed to say. Like, as I said, it is... It is pretty much time for the interval, and 20 minutes.
The arts. What are we to make of
the arts?
Indeed, what are the arts? How can we define what we mean by
the arts? Is art the expression of higher human spirit, or is it simply
the Ponzi stuff? What are we to make
of this?
Apart from a bonfire.
This is
art
with a capital F. It's weird when we consider what have been accepted as great works of art.
Take Constable's The Hay Wain. Now, this is basically a picture of some prat who's driven his cart into a pond. Van Gogh's pictures sell today for millions and millions of pounds. Here's one of them. It's a chair. Exciting, huh? Van Gogh is the only major artist to have got his models from Texas Home Care. But what of probably the most famous painting of all time, the Mona Lisa? Well, look at it carefully. That awkward pose, that dark background, that strange half-smile, this can only be a 16th century passport photo. This was the really crap one she used on her travel card.
What of other art forms? What of the world of the theatre?
The trouble with the theatre is that many people are put off it for life by being taken to see pantomimes when they are children.
But we should not take pantomimes too lightly. Underneath Cinderella is a damning indictment of crypto-matriarchal monarchist societies. Jack in the Beanstalk is a hard attack on the use of chemical fertilizers.
And Puss in Boots is a story about a cat that wears boots. The theatre also means Shakespeare. Now, many people find Shakespeare boring, but in fact, the Bard came up with many things that we still all know today. For example, Shakespeare invented the doctor-doctor joke.
Physician, physician, I keep thinking I'm a pair of curtains.
Well, fie upon you for a Rhenish knave, sirrah.
That may not seem funny now, but it wasn't then either.
Here, we must also mention ballet. At the ballet, you must be very careful what you say. Do say things like,
Karyarov, exquisite in his pas de deux.
Do not say,
who's the woofter with the big packet?
Such remarks immediately give you away as either a Philistine
or a young conservative.
The rest of us, well, what with Pavarotti and Nigel Kennedy in the charts, it does seem as if we are becoming more and more cultured. Who knows, if this trend continues, we may even find that our football supporters want to join in the trend.
We love you, England, we do. We love you, England, we do. But we acknowledge that other nations feel just as strongly about their teams, and we sympathise with that loyalty. We appreciate the opportunity to travel abroad and experience other cultures. Tomorrow night, we're going to see another butterfly. Mind you, afterwards, we are going to get completely rat-arsed, Brian.
Good evening. Would anybody like some milk? I was trying to sell it in the interval, but no one wanted any. It's not fresh. No, it's very warm. I'm very warm. That's because I only wear nylon. I wear it because it doesn't let your skin breathe. And if it gets wet, it dries without you having to take it off. I took it off once, 1967. I haven't only got milk, no. I've got cheese. I've got blue cheese. And I've got green cheese that I've been keeping in my airing cupboard. I've also got yogurts. I've got those new yogurts with yogurt on one side and fruit on the other, and you spoon it across. I don't use fruit. I use dead skin. I've been collecting it from in between my toes. I had athlete's foot for a while. Lovely. It's all pasteurised. Named after a man called Louis Pasteur, who devoted his life to making sure that milk was germ-free and hygienic to drink. What a bastard. Few germs never hurt anybody. No one ever died from eating a live yogurt. Well, my brother did. But he misunderstood. He got an ordinary yogurt and he plugged it into the main. Still, he was different to me. He was a little bit odd. Milky Milky.
Marvellous. Very good. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Very good. So, yes, back after the interval. And this is the point in the show where I always like to thank Chris, who's up at the back there. And Chris does our sound. And he also does our lights. Thank you, Chris. Oh, great.
And all because the lady loves milk. Try.
All right, fair enough, okay. Fine, yes, so it's jolly good. So, as I say, back after the interval, and one or two things that we'd like to make clear at this point of the show. Thank Chris, do that. And, one other thing, this is something I'd like to make clear on behalf of Hugh and myself, because a lot of people do come up to us and they say, "Ear, you're in that Mary White house, aren't you?" And I would just like to make quite crystal clear, here, now, and in public, that I have never been in Mary White house, right? Or have I? You never know. You never know. It was a sort of minor piece of showbiz gossip, I suppose, of the type that we do occasionally come across. We found out the other day, for example, and you may not be aware of this, that apparently Jason Donovan is so called because he is actually apparently the illegitimate offspring of Donovan, the 60s singer, and Jason, the dead cat from Blue Peter. But please keep that to yourselves, because we really shouldn't have told you that, because we could be very easily done for libel for saying that in a public place, although fortunately that doesn't generally matter with an Australian, because in Australia, libel is simply something that you find on the side of a wine bottle, so... So we're probably going to be okay with that one. Now, there's a couple of other things. First is a rather dull thing that we have to do.
We just have to do this little thing. I'm sorry about this, about the fire regulations. You may know that in theatres there's a sort of convention that if there's a fire, a message comes over the tannoy system.
Yeah.
In the West End, it's generally something like, Mr. Sands is in the bar. Yeah. It's coded, you see. It's coded. The staff understand it. And so you don't panic. And so the staff can escape.
True.
Here, though, the convention is rather different. Here, if you hear, Mr. Sands is in the bar, what that means is that, Mr. Sands is in the bar. He's not bothered to come out for the second half. No. What happens here is that I will wave my arms rather like this, and we will say, "There's a huge fire! Get the fuck out of here!"
Is that all right? I think that's okay. That's the way it will be.
It's a little bit cryptic.
A bit cryptic, but I think we're okay. It is this code business. It is just a sort of stupid bit of. It's a stupid bit of theatre etiquette, you know. It's just one of those stupid theatre etiquette things. Like you probably know, for example, you're not supposed to say the word Macbeth in a theatre, you know, which is just
Macbeth.
I mean, for heaven's sake, it's just absolutely, you know. Ridiculous. And but the British, unfortunately, we are a little bit obsessed with these, these sort of little etiquette things, you know, learning which side to put your fish knife and how to shake hands with the Lord Mayor and all that sort of rubbish.
I read this thing that said you should never turn your back on the Queen.
No, this is true.
Did you know that?
This is a useful tip.
Apparently you should never, ever turn your back on the Queen. In case you nick something, presumably.
They must have got it from somewhere.
Yes.
But the point is, you see, the point is that I cannot get worked up about these trivial little things.
Because they're trivial things.
Trivial little things. When there are far more important things.
Far more important things that we ought to be worrying about.
For example, think of the terrible things.
Terrible things
that we are doing to our environment. Did you know that every year we destroy an area of rainforest the size of Belgium?
Why not just destroy Belgium? It's so much easier and it's so much more environmentally sound.
And it's so much more fun, for God's sake. But all these terrible things are happening, these terrible, terrible things, the ozone layer's going, the ice caps melting, you know, acid rain, the sea levels are rising. We need to be teaching our children about these things. We should be teaching them right from the nursery to make sure that their generation don't make the same mistakes. We should be teaching them right from the nursery, teaching them rhymes like,
Dr. Foster went to Gloucester in a shower of rain. He stepped in a puddle right up to his middle and said, "Why is this water taking all the skin off my legs?"
Red sky at night, shepherd's delight. Sheep drowned in mourning, global warming.
Mary, Mary, quite contrary, how does your garden grow?
Upwards!
No.
see?
Don't care.
We don't care about these trivial little
trivial
things.
Why
don't we care? Why
don't
we care? Why don't we care? Because we think, well, it doesn't affect me. It doesn't affect me here now at this very precise moment, but it does. It does. And I'll tell you one place, that affects all of us every day, and that is in the food. The food that we all have to eat. Feeling hungry?
Yeah.
Having a starter?
Yeah, egg mayonnaise.
You're having eggs?
Yeah, they're hard-boiled.
No, but the mayonnaise.
Oh, the mayonnaise! The mayonnaise.
What about the mayonnaise?
It's got eggs in.
Yeah, it's egg mayonnaise.
No. There's eggs in mayonnaise.
Yeah, hard-boiled.
No, they're raw.
Raw egg mayonnaise!
I think she was right about eggs, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, the government have known about it for years, you know, and now they have to kill all these chickens. It's not easy getting a chicken to eat camembert, I can tell you.
I read this thing that said that if you want to eat eggs, you have to boil them for 2 hours in Dettol.
Yep. I thought it was 4 hours.
I think I'll just have salad, you know.
No, that's out as well.
Did you see that thing on Channel 4? God, that was frightening.
Now, how about prawns?
What, with coastal pollution like we've got?
Oh, these are Mediterranean prawns.
That's even worse. The Med, that's full of raw sewage. And think of all that ambersol air that comes off when you're swimming. Try the tuna.
Tuna, no, it's pumped full of mercury. The moment you put that in your mouth, it'll tell your temperature.
Plus, it's with mayonnaise.
I read this thing that said that if you want to eat eggs, you have to boil them overnight in Domestos.
Well, what about the chicken?
Ah, as long as it's properly cooked.
Did you see that thing in the Observer? God, that was frightening.
Full of listeria, you know.
What's that now?
Well, it's sort of hysteria about the list of things you can't eat nowadays. It's all to do with battery hens. Apparently, see, some battery hens can live longer than others.
The Duracell ones.
Oh. Very. This is a serious subject. Look, try the lamb.
Might be radioactive.
Well, all right. Slice of beef.
Might be full of hormones.
Well, surely you'd know.
Not if they'd given it a shave. How about beef burger?
No. I read this thing that said that for burgers, they're allowed to just grind up the entire bull apart from its...
Yeah, I saw that too. How about fish?
Fish with the Irish Sea radioactive, the North Sea pumped full of enough chemicals to win a medal at the Olympics.
Did you see that thing on BBC Two? God, that was frightening.
Absolutely. Well, look, what about potatoes?
Dusted with pesticide.
Tomatoes?
Sprayed with insecticide.
Raymond Burr?
Man called Ironside.
Yeah. Lettuce?
Too much fat?
Steak and kidney pie.
Whose kidneys?
Whose kidneys?
Hey, whose kidneys? You never know now, they say.
No, and all the vegetables will be sprayed?
No, they're all organic.
Yeah. Ah, they'll all be mouldy then. Well, what about the fruit salad?
Ah, they don't wash it properly, do they? No. They cover it in wax, then coat it in processed sugar and cream.
Cream? You might just as well dial the cardiovascular unit, put yourself in early, that's what I say. What about a glass of wine?
Wine? No, it's full of additives plus all that alcohol.
Did you know it's actually a poison? Mind you, my Uncle Tim, he drank 4 pints a day every day of his life. He only died last year.
How old?
36. How old? Mineral water?
Full of bacteria.
What about tap water?
Only if it's lead-free.
Oh, well... How about a banana?
A banana? No, you eat too many of them, you'll actually turn into one.
Did you see that thing in Sunday Sport? God, that was drivel.
Well, what about just a grape?
Grape? No, I read this thing that said that when they pick grapes, they stuff them up their noses, they dip them in untreated nuclear waste, then spray them with cyanide.
They don't tell you these things, do they?
They don't tell you.
Well, just coffee for me, then.
Caffeine, it's bad for me.
Absolutely. Cheese?
Nope.
No. Well, we've been through the entire menu. There's not a single dish.
Did you see that thing on Sky Channel?
No, neither did I. See, I don't mind. I don't mind us mucking up the environment for ourselves, but the thing is, it does also tend to affect every other species on the planet, you know? I mean, a lot of endangered species on this planet at the moment, as I think we all know, if we have watched that marvellous television programme, Harry and the Hendersons.
What a marvellous show.
What a very, very fine programme that is, ladies and gentlemen.
It moved me through the entire gamut of emotional response.
What an extraordinary, in no way was the licence fee wasted on that programme. I mean, for example, you know, isn't it just great, like, the way you can't tell that it's a bloke in a suit? I mean, just marvellous piece of televisual art there. And, of course, the great thing about Harry and the Hendersons is that you're supposed to feel sorry for Harry because he is the last of an endangered species. But you watch that programme carefully, right? You look carefully at Harry's anatomy. It's very obvious why he is the last of an endangered species.
Big foot, no knob.
You know, that's basically what it boils down to. I mean, if you're going to... make the programme, at least have the courage to do it properly. But I mean, those species are in danger. There are a lot of endangered species. So what do we do about it? Well, some people say put them in a zoo. You know, at least they're safe there from poachers, that sort of thing. But a lot of other people disagree with that. They say, no, a zoo is not a nice place to put an animal. I've never actually bought this argument myself, to be quite honest, because you're not telling me that if certain endangered species weren't actually happy in the zoo, that they couldn't do something about it. I mean, you're not telling me that if a rhino decides that, it isn't sort of happy in the safari park, that it couldn't do something about it. I mean, this is 3.5 tons of solid muscle, blood and bone. Surely, if a rhino wants to get out of the safari park, it can.
I'm really pissed off in here. I'm going to bust my way out. Oh, bugger. Chicken wire.
It does a wash, to be quite honest with you. But no, I mean, those species do die out, though. Some species do become completely extinct. The dodo became completely extinct, mind you. Of course, the dodo deserved it, because the dodo, like the ostrich, is one of that... It is one of that select group of species which are known collectively as the flightless birds.
Flightless birds. What is the point of a flightless bird? Birds are meant to fly. That's why they're called birds. Oh, you're a flightless bird. Meet the incredible drowning trout.
Don't get too worked up, all right?
And his friend, Colin the claustrophobic mole. I'll tell you what kind of birds can't fly. Yes, I'll tell you what kind of birds can't fly. Bloody lazy birds. Bloody sit around on their ass all day doing nothing kind of birds. I mean, they've all got wings, haven't they? They've all got wings. Yes, they just can't be bothered to use them. What kind of a choice is that? What was the penguin thinking? If I keep these wings, I'll be able to fly where I want to fly, see whatever I want to see, do whatever I want to do, and if I get rid of them, well, I'll be able to waddle round this rock. And well done, the penguin, of course, all flightless birds have been so successful, haven't they? Like the dodo, the kiwi. You can't move for all the kiwis, can you? You can't get into Trafalgar Square, but for all the bloody kiwis, can you?
Sorry.
That's all right. That's all right, just, you know, calm down, you know, you shouldn't let it do this to you. It's not worth, you know, this amount
really,
of
I don't know
hassle.
What sort of, just, you know, don't, a bit sort of...
Don't let it get you like this, just keep it down. Just keep it down.
It's just some fucking penguins!
I know, there's some
such thing... They've got wings and they don't use them!
It's completely stupid! You mustn't let it work you up to this extent. It just isn't worth the emotional stress, right? Just keep it... Keep it down.
Sorry.
Yeah. Just, you know, it really isn't worth letting it do this to you, okay?
Little black and white bastards! They get all those commercials!
I know, they get all those commercials! Don't worry about it. Just, you know,
Ooh, pick up a penguin!
No, for fuck off!
You should not let them do this to you, all right? This is just a moral victory for the penguins here, all right? Just quiet. But it is a bit odd, you know, it is kind of unnatural, like, you know, birds that can't fly, it is a bit weird. It's like mammals that can fly, you know, it's just odd. And this is why bats are so frightening. Now, have you ever actually seen a bat? It's extraordinary. It's like a gerbil hang gliding. Very, very weird. I sometimes wonder what poor old Noah makes about all this, because, of course, Noah went to all that trouble to save all the species on the planet to start with, and, of course, now here we are merrily wiping them all out again. Probably, of course, the greatest natural disaster in the entire history of the planet, the Great Flood. The entire planet flooded for 40 days and 40 nights, and I bet I know what happened the very next day. Everyone suddenly knew loads of jokes about it. Because... I'm fascinated by this, right? I'm fascinated. Whenever you get a big disaster, the very next day, Everyone knows loads of jokes about it. And it's the same joke up and down the country. Every school playground, every pub, every office. Everyone knows who makes these jokes up and how do they get round so quickly, you know? And this is not a new thing either. This is not a new thing. Jokes have always followed big disasters. I know that archaeologists were digging in some Roman remains and they found some graffiti on a wall in Latin that said, how many Pompeii residents can you get in the back of a chariot? All of them, if you've got a shovel. So, as I say, it isn't a new thing, but now I do wonder about poor old, Noah and what went on.
I am Noah, the greatest conservationist that ever lived. Let me tell you how it all happened. Well, it must have been about, 900 BC and something. It was a Sunday afternoon. I know it was a Sunday because I've been watching Bullseye. When suddenly, this cloud cleaved in two and a great booming voice said, Noah! There is to be a deluge, for I have beheld the corruption of the earth. Now, at first, I thought it was the man from the TV detector van. But then I realised it was the Almighty. But I had no idea what he was going on about. Fortunately, he undertook a slight rephrasing. Noah, he said, the bunch of you have been bad lads and now it's going to piss down. The upshot was, he wanted me to save the planet. Apparently, it had come down to a choice between me and Sting. And I got it on the basis I wasn't a balding, unshaven ex-English teacher with an annoying voice. Anyway, the Almighty told me to go away and build an ark. And then save two of every species on the planet. Oh, that's easy, that, isn't it? Oh, that's a piece of piss, that, isn't it? I mean, there's 5,000 species of insects alone. You know how difficult it is to trap a wasp under a jar, let alone two of them, of different sexes. And how do you tell them apart anyway? It's not like the male wasp always wears Y-fronts and leaves a bog seat upright, is it? Anyway, some of the animals they didn't have to take. I mean, the birds, they were all right. I merely gathered them together, asked them how many of them could soar majestically on the warm upcurrents of the trade winds. The eagle, the osprey and the kitty hawk said that would be fine. Chicken was less confident. So I let him on board. Oh, he had problems. I mean, choosing just two of every species was a problem. The mammals. Oh, the mammals, they were the worst. Argumentative, you see. You try telling a pit bull that there is no room for him on the ark. Which is why I didn't. There were 74 pit bulls on in the end. Still, I'm glad I saved them now, because your pit bull does make a very good guide dog. The blind person never bumps into anybody. Come on, I mean, come on, let's be honest. I mean, tame animals just aren't that interesting, are they? They don't bother with them for the adverts, do they? You don't get Esso, put a guinea pig in your tank. Peugeot, the ring-tailed lemur, goes from strength to strength. Anyway, I digress. Oh, the flood. Oh, boy, did it piss down. Boy, did it piss down. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. Funny thing was, in parts of East Anglia, they still had a hosepipe ban. But then it stopped. So I got this dove, and I told him to go and get me proof that the waters were receding. 3 hours later, he came back with a packet of silk cut and a carton of milk. And I released the animals. I think I did quite well, actually. In the end, to be honest, I'd rather more species than I started out with, due to a little bit of crossbreeding. One little crossbreed was half Labrador puppy and half leopard. If it ripped your arm off, it brought you a bog roll to mop it up with. Only one thing I regret, though. Why did you just save those fucking penguins? You know what I mean? They're just little black and white...
Let it get to you, Ben. Let it get to you, Ben. No, it is that. It is. Oh, bloody hell. What the fuck was that? No, it is, though. It is an interesting story, though, because even then, you see, even then when they wrote that, they knew you needed to take two of every species because they had to be able to breed. And we still do this today, of course, and this is why the animal that I would most hate to be on the entire planet is a panda. Because they lead such a humiliating existence. They spend almost all of their lives being flown around the world in an attempt to get them to cop off with each other. And it never works. And why should it work? I mean, for a start, it's a terrible culture shock for the poor thing. You know, one minute it's there in a nice little bamboo grove somewhere in the middle of China. Next minute, someone comes along with a tranquilizer gun, shoots it, nails it into a crate, bungs it on a plane, flies it 6,000 miles across the sea, sticks it in a strange zoo, in a strange cage with a strange panda it's never met before in its life, and it's supposed to immediately think, oh, I'm right up for a shag now. Oh, yes, of course it doesn't work, for heaven's sake. They're trying it now. They're trying it in London Zoo at the moment. They've got this panda there. They've flown over from Washington Zoo. They're going to try and mate it in captivity. This isn't going to work either. I mean, for a start, it's going to be like any other American in London for the first time. The zookeeper will be pointing at the pile of straw saying, there it is, get on with it. The panda will be saying, oh, gee, can we go see the changing of the guard now down at Buckingham Circus? Only some of those soldiers are wearing my friends on their heads. I mean, of course it doesn't work. And for heaven's sake, right, can you think of a less conducive environment for getting on with that sort of activity than the zoo? I mean, trying to get down to it on a sort of concrete floor with straw there, people leering in at the bars at you the whole time. I mean, if they really want to help these animals to breed successfully in captivity, the first thing they want to do is take them out of the zoo and put them into one of those places where you cannot help but think about sex. Like a crowded bus, for example. Oh shit, that's just me, isn't it? Oh my God, I can't believe it. I'm incredibly embarrassing.
It says in the Bible that the promised land is a land of milk and honey. I don't like honey. And Cleopatra, she bathed in milk. I did that once. I didn't get out for 5 days. And then I couldn't get out. I was trapped in 100 weight of cheddar. Lovely. Actually, I'm not very well. I'm not very well at all. I'm going into hospital tomorrow. I'm having my pants removed. It's a 5-hour operation. An hour to remove them and 4 hours to get them to Sellafield for reprocessing. Still, if I die in hospital, I know that I have led a very full life. A very full life indeed. Only one thing. I've never had a girlfriend. No, I've never had a girlfriend. Are you not very well? Well, I did have a girlfriend once, but we didn't get very far. She asked me if I would French kiss. I said, no, I would rather Belgian kiss. It's like a French kiss, but with more phlegm. Milky, milky.
Hello, and welcome to DIY for you, the programme for all you do-it-yourselfers out there. Now, some people think that home improvement is boring. We're here to show you that it isn't.
Now, last week, I fit into my dog basket with a tasteful Georgian carriage mouse.
And I did this. Now, painting.
There are three sizes of paint roller you can choose from. This is for radiators and awkward corners. This is for ordinary wall surfaces. And this is for lazy bastards.
Coming up later, our regular tiling feature, grout about. Some simple home plumbing.
Yes, first, with a dripping tap, many people call in a professional plumber.
Now, there's really no need for this. There is no mystery about plumbing, and I, for example, fitted my own central heating system, and you'd never know the difference. Except that the toilet now flushes at 100 degrees centigrade. And I don't advise using the bidet. Except for boiling the bag kippers.
Derek, last week you decided to have your loft converted.
That's right, and my loft is now Roman Catholic.
Now, one problem DIY enthusiasts can face is that they run out of things to do with their house.
Now, if this is the case, why not turn to outdoors? Last week, for example, I pebble-dashed my caravan.
And I put stone cladding on my Austin Allegro. Not only does it look terrific, it also slightly improved the acceleration. And finally, Derek has received a letter from a Mr. Harrison regarding a traditional problem faced by many DIY fanatics.
Dear Derek, when I announced that I was going to put a power shower in the fridge, my wife told me I was the most boring DIY-obsessed husband in the world. Well, we had a jolly good laugh about that. And then she left me.
Never mind, Mr. Harrison. If your wife's left you, you'll just have to do it yourself.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, and this is tremendously exciting because you join us here in Atlanta for live coverage of the 1996 Olympic Games. This promises to be very exciting indeed. The Americans are promising to outdo the spectacle even of 4 years ago in Barcelona. So we await now for the arrival of the outgoing President Clinton and the new president-elect, Macaulay Culkin. And, of course, Britain's guest of honour here is Prince Edward, who is here with his new bride, Sonia. Good evening. And up above the stadium there, I can see the flag, the famous Olympic flag, fluttering there, fluttering like a great white flat wingless bird that's been steamrolled and tied to a pole. And on it, of course, the five endless rings, symbolising, of course, the five endless weeks of television coverage. Now, we already have some news in for you. Firstly, of a medal for Britain, the medal in the super heavyweight weightlifting division. And I've just been told that's well done there. Gold for Philip Schofield. And I'm also hearing terrible news of at least three confirmed fatalities in the new exhibition event, the 100 metres javelin relay. Sounds a little bit nasty, but still down on the track. That puffer smoke and a leg crack means that this Olympic 1500 metres is underway. 15 athletes, only one of them can win. Come to that, only one of them come 15th. What a bloody stupid thing to say, but never mind. Because if they come off the first, Ben Lee, early leader is Daniels, this big American. He was born in Newark. He's a third-year student at Princeton University. He's studying economics, astrophysics, and running very fast. He trains at altitude, running up and down the inside of the plane on the way here. And while I've been telling you all that rubbish about him, he's dropped back into eighth place anyway. And now there is British interest in this race because this is Britain's Ian Johnson. Johnson for Britain powers his way up through the field and he's taken the lead. Johnson for Britain has taken the lead, and this man likes to lead from the front. What a marvellous piece of running, and he of course is closely followed by Archimedes, this big, big, huge, powerful Brazilian who runs like a panther. And if only he could learn to use just two legs, he'd be absolutely unbeatable. Still a tremendously exciting race developing here, so let's go straight over now to Jim Rosenthal.
You're just time for the ITV Sports Trivia Quiz. Here's the question again. Which ITV sports commentator knows fuck all about sport?
Well, a bit of a tough one there. I do apologise, ladies and gentlemen. We are getting very little sense out of any of our sporting commentators, so let's go over instead to our political commentator.
The atmosphere at Westminster. I've just been handed a joke. What to call an athlete who breaks wind in your beer? Fortum a Whitbread.
Well, I think that that is probably an appropriate point there at which to move on. This is point in the show where we do like to move on. We like to move into basically a little bit of a sort of... we like to move into a little bit of a...
This could be a potential death threat.
Now, as I say, we do like at this point in the show, we do like to move on into a little bit of a sort of a story type thing. We like to do a little sort of a story thing for a little kind of narrative thing. And we were thinking, first of all, we think what would be a suitable sort of story to do. And we thought, okay, well, first off, let's make it easier. Let's pick a story. Let's pick a story that we all know. So, you know, what kind of stories do we all know? Well, we all know those sort of panto, fairy tale type stories because we've all learned those when we're kids. Quite why we learn those stories when we're children, I've never really understood. Because, in fact, if you look at them closely, a lot of them are actually very unsuitable for children. They're given a lot of very odd ideas about the world that they're going to grow up in. If you take as an example, take Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Now, what is that about? That is about three bears who live in a house. Now, children in 1992 are not stupid. They're thinking, how does an 8-foot wild ursine carnivorous quadruped arrange a mortgage? You know, I mean, why do it now? And also, right, these bears, these huge, giant, carnivorous animals, what do they eat? Porridge. The well-known staple diet of bears, obviously, you know, and obviously porridge as well, you know, like bears wouldn't eat Weetabix, you know. They wouldn't eat Pop-Tarts, you know. I mean... So, would anybody eat Pop-Tarts, to be fair?
Oh, yum, 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 Pop-Tarts.
No, Pop-Tarts. Anyway, these bears, right, these bears that live...
So hot, they're cool!
These bears, not only do these bears eat porridge, but apparently they have a very bizarre way of going about making their porridge, because apparently they get up in the morning, get out the Quaker oats, whack it in the pan, stir it all up, you know, take a lot of trouble, a little bit of salt, a little bit of milk, stir it up so it's really nice. Right, the porridge is ready, everybody. Let's go for a walk.
I could understand it if it was Pop-Tarts.
Obviously.
Do you know what I mean?
Bears that live in a house. Now, houses tend to feature a lot in these kind of stories. Another one that features a house is Hansel and Gretel, only this time, if you remember, it's a house built entirely out of gingerbread, which has got to be somewhat of a problem if they ever have to get a builder in.
Oh, my good God. Oh, my God, God, look, there's your trouble. You see, some cowboy's built that. He's only used one egg.
Oh.
Unbelievable, isn't it? Who done that for you? Mr. Kipling, was it? Or was it same bastard built them Pop-Tarts? Going to be. Oh, yum, yum, yum,
now,
yum, yum.
Another one.
Look delicious.
Another one. Another one that's obviously eminently suitable for children is Snow White. Now, what happens in Snow White? In Snow White, a young girl is driven out of her house by a pathologically jealous stepmother who is told by a talking mirror,
"Mirror, mirror on the wall, your pension fund is worth sod all."
What is she told? What is she told by this talking mirror? She is told that she is no longer the fairest of them all. The young girl then promptly goes off into obligatory lonely wood and promptly shacks up with seven midgets of varying social disabilities.
Got any Pop-Tarts?
It's marvellous.
Oh,
marvellous stuff for kids,
yum,
I think
yum,
you'll find.
Yum.
And another one. Nice, another one is Rapunzel. Rapunzel, the world's most stupid story or what? I don't know if you remember Rapunzel, but Rapunzel is the one about the beautiful princess who is trapped at the top of a tower, and obviously the way that she decides that she's going to get out of this tower is she decides she's going to grow her hair so long that it reaches right down to the ground so the handsome prince can climb up the hair in order to rescue her. And I've always wanted to know what happened when he got to the top.
I didn't know you had dandruff.
Ah, now, here, while we're on the subject of bizarre things that we retain from childhood, I would just like to make something clear here, just before we leave this subject, because there was a particular sketch in the series that concerned childhood, which got a great deal of complaints, and I couldn't believe that people were actually complaining about this sketch. It was a sketch in which I blew up Hugh's teddy bear, and... oh, no, now, this is precisely... This is precisely what I'm talking about. You see, I must explain something to you. If you didn't see it, it was just a sketch about how people cling on, you know, they cannot let go of the soft toy that they've had as a kid. And what I really must explain to you, you see, is that the teddy bear that you saw was not really Hugh's teddy bear. It was basically just a BBC prop, you know, and...
It's teddy! It's not my teddy, no. It's on a BBC prop. No, this is teddy. Look, it's waving to you. He loves to be tickled. Listen.
What we said was, you bring him on, you show that the real... Yes, I know he's your teddy, but you said that you bring him on, right, you show that the real one wasn't damaged, and then we get on, because we haven't got all night, so, you know. Oh, come on, look, come on, just hand him over, come on.
He is not coming with you! Because the last time you blew him up! No, he's fine with me!
Come on, please. I know he's your teddy. I'm not saying that. Just, you know, please.
I will ask him. Do you want to go with Steve? Remember that he blew you up. he said he will come.
All right, good.
Because he knows there are no explosives.
There's no bloody explosives. I'll just put him on the
fridge. Later we have a tea party with some proper cups.
All right.
He can have a good view.
Yeah, all right. I'll
say
good
bye to Ted.
Yeah, all right, come on.
Bye, Ted.
Yeah, all right, fine, good.
I love Teddy, you're my favourite Teddy. All I mean is I was 2 years old. He has got lovely, lovely, lovely. And he's waving with his feet. He loves to be tickled.
I think that's...
I have been suckered again!
Yes.
I will get Teddy's daddy, who is big! You are in deep shit!
Hey! What's this?
Got a good beat.
Comes out of cows, what supports a young mammal, what's produced by all creatures from koibu to camel, what contains lactose and much, much, much more. You can buy it in shops or it comes straight to your door. What gives the nutrients young animals need? What gives them their vitamins before they can feed? What results from lactation sits in cartons on shelves? Or there's that advert with bottles that run about by themselves. Not put in the fridge. What can be made into Nesquik but not a sandwich? What's all full of germs till it gets pasteurized? Sits in supermarkets all different sized. Can be used for rice puddings or put in a sauce or poured over cornflakes or muesli, of course. It's an essential ingredient if you're making cheese. It has to stay cold but don't allow it to freeze.
Don't plug it in. They advertise milk on the telly. Some like it fresh. Not me. I like it smelly. I just open the car. yogurts in their fridge. I know, I've got a better place. I'm eating in my pants. It's nice and warm down there. Actually, I'm not just interested in metal. No, I'm also a sex machine.
Simon Bates isn't going to play this.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.